And I would urge you to give me opportunity to congratulate you in the probably second week of June. My best wishes that you get the service of your choice. But I hope that those who know either personally me or Chanakya Mandal would also know that my best wishes are for something beyond second week of June. The best wishes are for each of us to emerge as an excellent officer. The bureaucratic system may be full of IAS, IPS officers, etc. We won't be happy with just having IAS, IPS officers. We would feel proud if all of you emerge as officers known for their integrity, for their competence. Here at Chanakya Mandal, we define excellence in very simple words. Who is an excellent officer? The only words are two words. One who is honest and the one who is efficient. Only one is not sufficient. Just being honest or just being efficient is not sufficient. But my best wishes to all of you. And in three broad sections, let us focus on how to prepare for this personality test. I presume all of us know what is the basic nature of this personality test. You have given the prelims, which was the test of your command over information. You have also given and cleared the main examination, which was the test of your knowledge. So it is ability to collate information, interpret, analyze, discuss, explain, give your opinions, etc. Now you are past that. Now personality test is neither the test of your information nor the test of your knowledge. A beautiful word to be used is personality test is the test of your wisdom. Personality test is the test of yourself, capital S, self, your personality. Once you remember this, you are going to get the key to understand the entire method of facing an interview board. And so my next most important point, see, these three beautiful words are usually used and they relate to each other, the information, the knowledge and the wisdom. Information is I know a lot of data, I have by heart it, and I can put it on paper. But knowledge is ability to collate information, to relate information, to find out the meaning out of it. But wisdom goes much, much beyond that. Wisdom is your ability to apply it in day-to-day life situations. That we have read lots of books, we have recited quite a lot, that we are smart, that we can talk is fine. But the test of personality is how you come across. And it would include all kinds of these things. How you stand, how you wish, what kind of clothes you are wearing, how you sit down, what is your body language, what are your eyes reflecting, what is your face reflecting, how do you speak, what is the pitch of your voice, what is your command or vocabulary, and on and above all, what is your thinking? Given a situation, how do you face? If the board is hostile, are you able to keep smiling? If the board is cooperative, are you able to not get carried away? If you come across simple questions, do you feel elated? If you come across difficult questions, do you feel flustered? This is what is tested, personality test. So, my most important suggestion about how to face an interview board or how to prepare for personality test is a very simple suggestion in words. Very simple to state in words, very difficult to enact. The suggestion is, be your natural self. Nothing arbitrary, nothing artificial. Just be basically what you are. Don't try to be what you are not. There is this beautiful poem by none other than Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore. And I remember the first line. The first line is, oh God, let me not present myself wrongly to the world and set it against me. That's the first line. This is from Gitanjali. Maybe we think that now we are to face the interview, so what? I have to have a hobby, then develop a hobby. I have come across youngsters who didn't have a hobby, but they thought it's compulsory to have a hobby or it will show you in a bad light that you don't have a hobby. So someone said, reading is my hobby. Now he hadn't read books, so what he would do? These introductions to books that appear in various magazines. So he would only read those introductions. His plan was, if asked which books you have read, he would tell, I have read this book, V.S. Naipaul's Half a Life. He hasn't read, But then someone says, please tell us about Half a Life. Then he will tell on the basis of the introduction about the book that appeared in some issue of India Today. Actually, this is hypocrisy. Being one's own self. I can make it out from your eyes that you are listening carefully and you are thinking online. Maybe you are thinking that being one's own self is the most difficult thing. Because for being one's own self, you have to know what is yourself. Capital S. What are your natural styles? How do you sit down? How do you stand? What are your strong points of the personality? Subsequently, I am going to suggest you how you maneuver your interview to bring the questions on your strong points. One has to know what is myself. That needs a lot of introspection, understanding. That needs, I would say, surrendering of ego, which is a huge point, which maybe I start talking to also after you succeed in the examination. This kind of introspection to know, so that how I would come across. Now, being one's own self doesn't certainly mean that if you normally wear shabby clothes, then also face the interview in shabby clothes. It doesn't mean either way that you have to wear a three-piece suit or a suit or a tie, etc., etc. I'm going to focus on those issues. Being your natural self means being cool, being relaxed, understanding who you are, what you are, not don't try to be what you are not. It doesn't mean a fine-tuning is not required. A fine-tuning is required. A certain basic polish is required. It's like a lamp. So a lamp, to be lighted properly and to give excellent light, we polish it. Maybe we polish the lamp. We remove the dirt from the lamp. But the innate light within the lamp is what the light, what is the light, is the light that lamp would give. Greatest of the suggestion, the most important of the suggestion is be your natural self. Don't try to be what you're not. This would also mean don't compare yourself with someone else. And there are hundreds of factors which now we start opening up as I start talking to you. We think someone is tall and I'm not. So we start feeling what? Diffident? Inferior? We think someone else is handsome and I am not. Someone else is fair complexioned and I am dark complexioned. I am dwarf. I am this. I am that. Nothing. This also includes, in fact, so-called command over English. This includes your accent. You think someone speaking polished English does impress. And it does impress. It's a fact of life. So the person does impress. But if you are not that fluent, doesn't matter. Someone else, when you start talking to the person, is so knowledgeable that you start feeling inferior. Oh my God, you ask any question and this guy is able to answer. And I am not. And we start with, not, it's not required. I have this conviction that in fact what I am talking to you is not only valid for the interview, it's valid for life. Don't compare yourself with someone else. Each human being is unique under the sun in this universe. And still all human beings are one and the same. You are unique. Don't compare yourself with someone else. Try and find out what you are, what is yourself. Build your interview, then your career, and then your life on what you are, not on what you are not. Once you understand this, I would say practically rest of my talk is in fact not even required. We are going to spend a few minutes trying to understand some practical connotations of the point I just mentioned. Otherwise, now it's all clear. You start applying, use this as a yardstick for any question in your mind about the interview, about the career, and about your life. My suggestion to you would be to apply this criteria, what is my natural self? And be there. You are going to be happy. You are going to be successful. Having said this, let us try to focus on some practical issues. To start with, I have a few practical tips to suggest you. One is, for preparing your interview, possibly write down the answers that you are going to give. Are they of the proper length? Aren't they too short, not too long? Are they expressing the right kind of approach to answering the problem? But write them down. Be sure about the words. Second part will be, if possible, in fact, also get them audio and video recorded, which is what we are arranging also at Chanakya Mandal. This video recording and audio recording also would help you. Audio recording will help you understand what is your pitch. Is the voice proper? And it's a skill. It's called diction. It's a skill. The panel would be sitting at a distance of, say, about 2 meters from me, around a semicircular table. So what is the voice? If you speak too softly, you are going to appear kind of, let's say, diffident, submissive, confused, unsure of yourself. But if you are too loud, that the next candidate standing outside the room is also able to hear your answers, so that he gets the question paper in advance. Then the panel is what? Perhaps going to start thinking, are you too pushy, overconfident, not sure about the tone, trying to push? And in fact, the outward expression of overconfidence, let me tell you, more often than not, is in fact an expression of inner lack of confidence. In fact, being cool, being soft, being controlled, beautiful Indian word is sanyam, poise of the personality, is in fact reflects your confidence that you are in command of the situation. We start raising voice when actually we are not in command of the situation. When we are flustered, you try to make up for that, and then all these things happen. So get it audio and video recorded. Let the record be with you. Go through that again and again, and it will help you understand the video recording, like how you sit, how you stand, what do your eyes reflect, are you too tense, are you too relaxed, everything. And then answers also. Mock interview, of course, we are conducting. Something about English, those of us who are going to give your interview. This is, if you still have 2 or 3 weeks to go, I believe that you can improve your spoken English beyond your own belief within 2 to 3 weeks. We have a different session on that. There is a video recording available. Those of us who would find time may care to take your own time to go through that, how to improve English. I certainly today wouldn't have time enough to talk about how to improve spoken English. But focusing on English, those of us who are going to give the interview in English. And the last of the point would be outward appearance, where in fact I am starting the next section of my talk. The next section, now the remaining part I am dividing into 2 parts. One is some technical parts about the preparation for interview, and the other is more importantly content. How do we handle this one? Let's come to the technical part. It starts with your outward appearance. I have said be your natural self. But certainly the male folks may please be clean shaven. If you are keeping a beard, it should be properly trimmed. It's not that beard is not disallowed, but clean shaven, properly oiled, etc. About the clothes, my suggestion would be normal clothes, maybe a shirt, whether it may be a half shirt, a full shirt, so hopefully ducked into your trousers. The suggestion is they shouldn't be too bright colors, normal. The statement, you see, your clothes, your basic first appearance is your statement. You are making a statement. If you are wearing flamboyant clothes, flashy clothes, checks with flashy colors, checks with soft colors may be are advisable. But the normal this thing. Now, should you wear tie, should you wear three-piece suit or a suit is absolutely up to you. Anything in which you are comfortable. If you are wearing a shirt with full sleeves, then it should be cufflinks, it should be full sleeves, not Dharmadhikari style. Today I am not my natural self, I am a hypocrite. I am asking you to be natural self, I am not my natural self. So-called polished, so-called, okay. But it shouldn't be pulled up. This is my, personally, my natural style is, if I am wearing a full sleeve shirt, I wouldn't ever have these cufflinks, etc. It is ready to fight. Not in the interview. Okay, shoes, I don't have to tell you that a proper shining polish, etc., etc. Now, some of the magazines have been telling you that you must wear suit, etc. The magazines also depict the personality of a candidate like he is Amitabh Bachchan or Kajol or whatever. You have to be handsome, you have to be beautiful, you have to be wearing those light blue colors, sari or Punjabi or everything. Then you enter the hall, everybody is sitting in a morose position like ek dil ke tukde hazar hue. Then like a hero, you walk in and tell, come on folks, cheer up. So the other candidates start asking you that, I don't know the answer to this, would you please tell me? Then you start telling your answers, etc. Until your turn comes up, then you enter the hall, and instead of giving the interview, you start conducting the interview. Some of the magazines I have come across, they print standard interviews, standard questions, repeated just with names changed. and they call this the verbatim copy of an actual interview given. None of this is required. Be peaceful, be quiet. It doesn't mean that in the hall if someone talks to you, you don't talk to him or her. You can exchange. You are supposed to go with some certificates, etc. Go there, submit your traveling bill, etc., etc. Wait until your turn comes. Generally, a panel consisting of 5 conducts 5 interviews in the morning session, pre-lunch part, 5 interviews in the afternoon session. Depending on your luck, in this April or May heat in Delhi, you may get your number in the morning, in the afternoon. When you reach, you know which panel and at what number. The hall may be average this size, the one that we are sitting right now. There is a semicircular table, 5 people, chairperson plus 4. They are experts from various fields. They may be, some of them may be members of UPSC, high level intellectuals, serving or retired bureaucrats, 5 people. You are supposed to wait until your turn comes up. When the earlier candidate enters the hall, you are called up to sit on the stool. Years on end, I have cracking this repeated joke, hopefully for the last time in my life and your life also. Because today we are getting it video recorded. This is strictly personal reason why we are doing it, because I feel fed up giving the same talk every year. How to prepare? This year we said, let us do this. And a person looks better on cassette than on actually. Next year's candidates are going to learn to respect me more than you guys, because you are actually seeing me. Seeing a person on TV is something different. And that is some surreal quality about it. But the same talk, etc. Okay. You are supposed to sit on a stool outside the room. Let this be the last time you are ever required to sit on a stool. So you just wait. Be quiet. Be just cool. Okay. Then your turn comes up. Knock the door softly. The earlier candidate walks out. The door may on its own close. Then knock the door softly. Open it. And from the door, ask, may I come in, sir? Sir, or if the chairperson is a lady, then say, may I come in, madam? Your first address should be to the chairperson. About the speech, etc., diction, etc., I am coming to this point in a few minutes. May I come in? Then you would walk. Your walking matters, how you walk. Today we may not have all this to talk about. Henceforth, a large impression is created by your body language. It says, how you walk. Do you drag your feet? Do you walk with your shoulders drooping, with your head drooping, like a person about to be guillotined now? Okay, Aliya Bhogasi Asave Sadara, now that you have no option but to face the interview, here am I, but don't cause pain, huh? Please be soft, etc. Or do you come across as a, how do you walk? Some little training may be required, even there may be 4 or 5 steps. How do you walk? Okay. Stand by the side of or behind the chair that is kept for you. I am afraid especially Maharashtrian students need to be told to have some manners. And I have every immoral right to tell you about manners, because I am the person who doesn't have any. For a short while, I created a show sometime in the month of April, May 1986, that I seem to have some manners. The panel was misled not to sit down until you are asked to sit down, or how to wish. Wishing. So when you approach the chair, wish. If you are in the morning part, obviously it is good morning. You can also say namaste, namaskar. There is no reason to feel shy about it. It's not necessary that it has to be good morning, etc. Good morning, good afternoon. You can say namaste. But address the chairperson first. Good morning, sir. Then address everybody. Good morning to all of you. Then apart from the chairperson, if there is a lady sitting on the panel, make it a point to address to her separately. Youngsters need to be told this in every situation other than the interview. You don't need to be told to address a lady separately. There you are more than enthusiastic to do. God bless your age and God bless you. But on the interview panel, there is a senior lady sitting there, and don't just end up by saying good morning, sir, and good morning to all of you. No, good morning, sir, good morning, madam, and then good morning, all of you. As you do this, also make it a point to look at everybody. Now these are subtle points of body language, looking at. I would be looking here, I would be looking here. I would not be looking at you, I would say, just say good morning everybody. I said, and hell with you. I mean, the words say good morning, the tone says hell with you. So the words and the tone should match. Then don't sit down until you are asked to sit down. The panel would have your one page biodata, the one that you fill up. Maybe by now you may have filled up and sent it. It has that one. It doesn't have your score for the main exam, etc. Of late, I am given to understand that actually it also has the fact whether you have given previous attempts. Especially, what you filled up in the columns in previous attempts. And then the panel is almost bound to ask you a question. Subsequently, we come down to the content part. If there is a change in some of the answers you filled up on the form in your earlier attempt and now, then rest assured you can presume that the panel is going to ask you, why did you say this? In the last year's attempt, you said your favorite game is football. Now you are saying your favorite game is cricket. In the last year, you said you are doing a job. This year, you have said you are not doing a job. What happened? Are you dismissed? Are you fired? What happened? Did you say football last year because it was World Cup this year or whatever? Changes in the answers. If there is a history of your previous attempts, then please go through that. But the panel wouldn't have anything that biases the mind of the panel. So it is score, marks you have scored in the mains, etc. It's like your basic biodata before the panel. So maybe the chairperson is going through the biodata. Maybe chairperson has his or her own decision about testing you. 99%, the moment you approach and say, good morning, sir, good morning, all of you, good morning, madam, before you finish that, the chairperson is likely to say, okay, good morning, take your seat. Then say, thank you, sir, and make it a point to sit down without making the noise of the chair. We Maharashtrians, Rakata Desha, Kankhara Desha, Dagadancha Desha, etc., we make this noise. No. Once he asks you to sit down, say, thank you, sir. Make it a point to smoothly drop into the chair. No noise, no sound. It is a chair with hands, not this kind of, but this, by and large, the shape would be the same one. So just sit down softly. Yeah. Then your sitting posture. Don't sit at the edge of the chair. Neither this nor this. Relaxed. There is even a better position, which I would call, in fact, is a Maharashtrian position. Shoot your questions. Here am I. No. Your sitting should indicate balance, poise. Your sitting should indicate your balance, poise. So what are the exact suggestions? Even distance in your legs. If at all one may be so technical, somewhere between say 8 to 11 inches. What is the criteria? Your shoulder length, boy, width, that much. You should be relaxed. Your back should be touching the back of the chair. Have both the hands on the hands of the chair. Whether they are like this or like this depends on which yogic practice you follow. That's up to you. You can place them like this, you can place them like this on your thighs. Just be relaxed. By and large, the chin should be parallel to the ground and everything. I am not describing the attention position in NCC, but alert and relaxed. And I mentioned the attention position in NCC because actually that attention is nothing but how are you alert and relaxed. And in fact, then again I presume that you know that you cannot be alert unless you are relaxed. And you cannot be truly relaxed unless you are alert also. How do you sit down and wait for the answer? No fretting, no fuming. There are various body signals which we pass across. What happens? Pit-pitting of our eyes. Pit-pitting is Bombay English, Bombay College English. This reflects unstable mind, tense mind. Or everything, or for every answer. Or you are fretting and fuming, changing hands, or shifting on legs as you sit down, or four position this way, four position that way. No, this will need a practice. Sitting in the chair in a relaxed, cool fashion without any fretting and fuming and all will need practice. I was referring to these manners that unless and until you are asked to sit down, don't sit down. And I also said that 99% of the times, the chairperson is going to ask you to sit down immediately, but he or she may not. Then coolly keep standing with a cheerful face, a smiling face. Now, this is a very significant thing, to wear a smiling face. Should I repeat that I'm not only talking about interview or personality test, my submission is, in fact, I'm talking about life. Life is full of dangers, ups and downs, setbacks and successes, etc., failures, etc. Who doesn't go through this? But by wearing a square face, by being tense, do you solve problems? One doesn't. Smile. Wear a smiling countenance. Now, it has to be so balanced that it should be only smile, not guffawing. You shouldn't look like you are ridiculing the panel. Or guffawing. It's a cool, poised smile, which may, if you're not so far into that practice, may need a little bit. In fact, the decisive feature of smile is not your cheek. It's your eyes. Correct reflection of the smile is in the eyes. So just keep smiling and keep standing. Now, if you're standing, it's not this. Not this. It is shoulder width. And stand coolly. Fretting and fuming of the hands, etc. So now neither stand at attention. Okay, you say, morning, sir. And sir, no, you have to be cool, relaxed. It is possible that in order to test you, the chairperson once in a while may make it a point not to tell you to sit down. And he may start questions. If he poses the first question, answer that question, and then with a smiling countenance ask, may I sit down, sir? No anger. Here am I standing, what does he think of himself? Isko dekh lete ek bar mujhe IAS hone do, fir usko dekh leta hun. Apne aapko kya samajhta hai, etc. This seething, boiling anger in your mind, but you keep standing and no. But answer the question and then ask, may I sit down, sir? Now, I would say that you are likely to come across two kinds of panels, broadly. Largest possibility is generally the panel would be friendly and cooperative with you. Personally, I would say then you are less lucky. But there would be those few lucky chaps, I hope all of you are that lucky, and I hope you are tough and competent enough to also face that you come across a hostile panel. The panel that decides to put you to test. That in initial stages especially, they act like they are your enemies. They fire questions at you. They don't allow you to answer fully. They cut you halfway through. The chairperson doesn't ask you to sit down, etc., etc. Pray God. Thank God in your mind. Thank the panel for being this, because in such a situation, if you don't lose your balance, if you are able to keep smiling, if your answers are proper, if you don't retort, no counter question, no flustering, etc., you are going to come out with double flying colors. So the possibility, you may come across both these kinds of things. Then sit down. I've already made a point that look at the person. Then the questions start. Again, 99.99% of the times, the chairperson would start the questions. While answering, look at the chairperson. Start your answer by looking at the chairperson. But don't just keep looking at the chairperson. There is a certain very subtle time frame beyond which that looking turns into staring. If I start doing this and I'm talking, looking only at him, then he feels uneasy. What has happened? Why is he staring at me? Various kinds of theories, etc. Not only that, but others start feeling that he is not talking to us. You are not talking to the floor, you are not talking to the ceiling, you are talking to the human beings sitting before you. So start your answer by looking at the chairperson and then look at everybody. But look, it is eyeball to eyeball contact. And that time frame, that correct time frame, which stops at the borderline of looking, and look at everybody. My suggestion also is in initial stages, although this is a part of content, and for the sake of continuity, I am likely to repeat it when I approach that in next few minutes. Don't suddenly start your lengthy answers. Don't be verbose in the beginning. At the start, let your answers be kind of one-liners, but let the line be full. Certainly not monosyllabic answers, not one word. Yes, no, okay, no, it should be the full line. But in the start, crisp, by and large, I would say, unless the very first question, if it demands analysis, if you are asked the very first question, which is very less likely, the likelihood is very small, that the very first question would be, please analyze Babri Masjid, Ram Janmabhoomi issue. You can't certainly give one line answer to this whole issue. But usually start with one-liners, then as the ice breaks, an interview proceeds beyond, let's say, first 2 or 3 minutes, then you can open up. Then your answers can be lengthy. But that length also should be properly coordinated. Talk to everybody, talk to, not talk at. I am talking and they are listening. No, they should feel that there is a personal communication, that this candidate knows communication skills, that he is talking to everybody. Also at the start of interview, in first few minutes, make it a point to start your answer by saying sir or madam. And again, that sir or madam should be judiciously balanced. Don't go on sirring. This is a bureaucratic practice. Beyond a point, this converts into sycophancy. And I'm afraid whether 1,000 years of slavery have built this sycophancy in Indian blood, your genes or whatever, one may have to correct. Sir, this is because, sir, I want to do, sir, I am thankful to you, sir, sir, I have never seen, sir, like a person, sir, like you, sir, 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 sir. In Marathi, we used to say, Jhadavar chadu naka. What is the balanced one? It's respect and not sycophancy. Start your answer by saying, you are posed a question, which are the newspapers you read? You can say, sir, I read Hindustan Times and Indian Express. Sir, I read Hindu and Indian Express. Or whatever, whichever are the newspapers you are reading. Or madam. It can be sir at the beginning or sir at the end. What are the newspapers you are reading? You can say, I read Maharashtra Times and Indian Express, sir. So, either way. Not too much, not too less. You don't mention sir, the answers even start sounding rude. You may not mean it. This is a very significant point, and so many times I have come across youngsters who are capable. I must be frank enough to tell you that, in fact, I belong to the list which I should tell you. I am afraid, and I am not even sure whether even today, without my intending to be so, am I perceived once in a while as a pushy, arrogant, who thinks too much of himself, etc. One has to be careful. We may not mean it in the mind, but outwardly you come across that. Among the, few of the reasons would be, you don't start or end your answer by saying sir or by wishing. You don't wish, etc. It's all presumed. Why is it required? Why should I say good morning? It is a good morning. Why should I say good morning? Why should I keep standing? These are subtle, small gestures of how you walk, how you look at a person, but they add up, go on adding up, and it's a combined message of your personality which starts getting imprinted on the minds of the panel, or in life also the human beings who come across you, they start perceiving you as pushy, overconfident, arrogant, thinks too much of himself without your intending to be so. You don't intend. If you are told, you feel hurt. And unfortunately, if your egos are swollen, in fact, you feel angry. How I wish that we are able to conquer our egos for our own development. And then it is also in the greater interest of the nation, but this is after you actually become officers. Otherwise, the system is full of tremendously egoistic officers whose egos are greater than the interest of the country, interest of the people. But this is some large learning process, I would say. So this balanced sirring or madam, sir or madam, as the interview proceeds, then beyond, say, first 10 minutes, you need not go on saying sir every time. You need not start or end every sentence or one-liners every time. But then it's sparingly. You are reminding you are conveying to the panel that you have not forgotten saying sir or expressing your respect for the panel. So this balance, sorry. Then the questions would continue. About voice and pitch. This is what I was also saying. Remember the distance. And remember the exact pitch of your voice. Not too loud, not too small. Now today we are going to record it. And when you hear that, that itself will help you understand the voice in which you are speaking. But it is not only the pitch, it is also the tone. Do you sound arrogant? Sometimes we do. Have you talked to various people on phone? Or go to an inquiry counter at railway, ask him, when is Rajdhani Express coming? And the answer would be the factual answer. So if it is 8:30 in the morning, I can say 8:30 in the morning. 8:30. What is that? My pitch, my diction makes the this second 8:30. I'm suddenly raising the voice. It's barking. It's retorting. Can't you see the schedule? Idiot. That tone indicates. Get lost is something tone indicates. I don't care is something tone indicates. That is your voice in addition to your face, etc. You start getting flustered. I have come across capable and intelligent youngsters who otherwise deserve to be IAS, IPS, but in the interview, on some or other question, they got so angry that they started giving it back to the panel. Not required. And I would say not there, not in life, not in the, not even when you become a bureaucrat. You see, after you become a bureaucrat, you're going to sit in positions of power. You don't need to lose balance. Your pen, your brain, your decision-making power does matter, so you can just stay cool. But this ability to stay cool under the situations of pressure, it reflects in your eyes, on face, and then the pitch of the voice. Also the clarity of your words. Fumbling. More often than not, we have this tendency that the last words are eaten up. That your voice descends as you start speaking the last words. And last one or two words is something nobody can catch up. Don't expect the panel to be experts in lip reading, so that they know what are the last words you said. Clarity of the voice. So clarity, pitch, and also the pace at which you talk. Some Marathi speaking, some English speaking, I have come across them. They speak so fast that the next word gets jumbled into the earlier word. And then the panel also has to be extra attentive to separate those words, pay attention, kind of online digital separation done by their brain to understand the words. So the pace. You shouldn't be very slow, like afternoon news reading, slow news reading. India announced, you can complete a sleep in between, in the gap. This is Atal Bihari Vajpayee's pauses. Today you are not Atal Bihari Vajpayee. You go on to become Atal Bihari Vajpayee, God bless you, God bless also the country. Pauses, huge pauses, not neither Atal Bihari Vajpayee nor Shekhar Suman. Big pauses, big distance, big gap, silence in two words. But the correct pause, if you are changing a line, the way you speak indicates syntax. Your speaking may indicate a comma, a semicolon, an exclamation mark, a question mark, a full stop, also a change of paragraph. This is voice, this is diction, and this is the pause, the correct pause, etc. The pace at which you speak, take care of this. I would say last of the points in technical category, after which I am shifting to the more important part. So the last is, after your interview comes to an end, and then the panel, it's again, more often than not, I would put it to 99.99%, again the chairperson would say, best wishes young man, or he indicates, or he tells you that, okay, thank you very much. Never add anything after the chairperson sums up the interview, closes the interview. Don't say, there is something more I wanted to say, may I complete the answer, etc. You get an indication that the chairperson is saying, time up. He doesn't say, he may not say time up, he says, thank you man, young lady, thank you, and all the best. And don't add anything, ek sangaycha rahilach hai. You keep thinking that my answer would appear incomplete. There is no incomplete answer, because the content of your answer matters less than how you handle the interview. If the chairperson has concluded, then don't add. Then you also stand up, say thank you sir, thank you everybody, thank you madam, good afternoon, have a nice day. And after that, just go back two steps this way. Don't turn from where you are standing. Otherwise the tendency is, again I would say quintessential Maharashtrian tendency is, get lost. Stand up without making the sound of the chair, get to the side, say thank you sir, thank you all of you, thank you madam, walk two steps back, then turn and quietly walk out of the room. Also the way you open the door, never forget that as long as the panel is seeing you, you are either directly or indirectly creating a certain impression on their mind. Don't think that you say thank you, have a good day sir, and you walk out, you, when the interview is closed in words, don't think that the interview is over. Interview is not over until you vanish from the view of the panel. So they are watching you. They are watching you how you walk out when you go outside, outside the room. How you open the door. Is it abrupt action? Or is it smooth action? Smooth, confident. How do you leave the door? Is it to open the door, walk out for the door itself to bang on to the other door? Or how do you close that and then walk out? All the technical parts. Now for a few minutes, let us focus on the content part. I have already said smile. I have already said relax, learn to relax and stay cool. I have already said initial answers may be one-liners. I have already covered the point about your voice. There also you will find that your initial answers may be in a bit of a low voice. Audible. Don't strain the ears of the panel. But if today you are watching me, I started in a softer voice. Then as it hits a tapto awaz, then it is normal voice in which you are used. Same is true for the interview. The initial answer may be soft. May be soft. Now my favorite, and I hope it's a favorite metaphor of all of you, it's like setting down on a pitch. You don't start stroke play right from ball number one. You take a guard, you ask the umpire, give me leg, you take a pose, and maybe for yourself, depending on your competence in batting or depending on the kind of balls, you have not come determined with any preconceived notion that on the very first ball I have to score a six. Or no, first three balls have to be played defensively. Maybe two on the front foot and one on the back foot. No, it is you play each delivery on its own merit. This is true for interview, this is true for entire life. Every situation in life has to be played on its own merit. No preconceived notion. You are there, relaxed and cool, but the mind kind of is vacant, waiting for whatever comes your way. But it is setting down on the pitch. So you are taking your own time. But if at all it's a full toss, nothing stops you from scoring a six then on the very first ball. So if it's a some question, which you know that you are very strong and your answer suddenly puts you in tremendously excellent light. But the pitch of the voice and as interview proceeds. Now there are certain no's, don'ts to be remembered absolutely. One of which I have already referred. And that is no monosyllabic answers. You are asked, why are you wearing this shirt? Or the first question may be, which color do you like? Blue. No. I like blue color, sir. This is the answer. Sir, I like blue, etc. Why are you wearing this shirt? My second no, don't is, don't give an answer which sounds like a retort. That is answering back. What sounds like a retort? If you say, why not? Why should I not? Or if the sentence is half a line, why are you wearing a blue shirt? I like it. Because I like it. This is, because I like is a half sentence. Sounds like a retort. Or, because I like it, depending on your voice, diction, etc., like I said, may indicate so many things. It may indicate a kind of curt answer. It may also indicate, who the hell are you to ask me? I will wear whatever, how does wear, what I wear matter? You ask me questions, etc. Because I like it. Face, eyes, because I like it. So it is, who the hell are you to ask me? No, full sentence and a matter of fact answer. I like blue color. Sir, I am wearing this shirt because I like blue color. So no, this. Make it a point. Never ever ask a counter question to the panel. Never ever. The only exception may be that sometimes you don't get the question, you don't understand the question, you don't understand the import. There very softly you can say, sir, I didn't get the question. Then you may add, would you please repeat, etc. But there again, should I say, especially Maharashtrian candidates need to be told not to say Quintessential Maharashtrian style. They ask, the panel ask some question, you say whatever. It could be whatever, depending on your purpose. No, if you have not heard the question, you can say, excuse me, sir, I didn't get the question. It could be, beg your pardon. But never ever ask a counter question on anything. Should VHP led or whatever, should they have reacted to Godhra incident? Your answer shouldn't be, why shouldn't they? Because this something was burned, why should, no, no counter question, no retort. Give your own answer. About that, what kind of answer, we are coming to that in a short while. Make it a point not to use a slang. We have this temptation. Especially in English, people think they used a four-letter word at the start of the sentence and at the end of the sentence, you sound like you are very confident. Never use slang, especially in the interview. People use slang to express anger, to express ease, to kind of act it as catharsis, etc., which outside the panel room, this is a possibility. But using slang, foul words, swearing, four-letter words, interview is not the place. Polished, chaste English, and those of us who are going to give in Marathi, etc. Don't use slang. Never ever enter into argument, argument with the panel. You may give an answer, the panel may not agree with it. Then you can say, but it's a heated argument, why not, why should we, no, after all I am of this view, etc. Then you can control the agreement, argument at a certain point. So you are asked, what is subtle diplomacy? And then you refer to Kissinger as Secretary of State traveling between China and USA to bring about what has been called as Sino-American Ditant. Before you start finishing the answer, the panel says, no, that is not the meaning of subtle diplomacy. And you can say, sir, I think to the best of my knowledge, this is subtle diplomacy. And even then someone insists, no, this is not. Then say, then I'm sorry, sir, this is my answer. Arguing with the panel, no, I didn't do this, no, I did this, etc. It brings to no head. Don't enter into especially bickering kind of an argument, quarrel kind of an argument. The panel may say, I don't agree with you. The name of Mumbai city, colloquially called in English as Bombay, and the Sena BJP government changed it to Mumbai. What is your opinion about it? You can say, whatever, you can say it was originally Bombay and it is narrow sectarian view, regionalistic or even linguistic or communal to change it to Mumbai. You can say that. Or you can say, no, our original Indian name was this because the Britishers couldn't pronounce, and with an independent country, we should also insist our names also should indicate independence. This has happened all over the country. This has happened in the world. So this is good. Fine. You give your answers, whichever is your honest answer. But the panel starts saying, disagreeing with you. You say the changing of the name was correct. The panel says, doesn't it indicate communal attitude? Sena BJP government did this. Doesn't it indicate a linguistic, narrow, sectarian, sons of soil theory, so-called sons of that Maharashtra is for Maharashtrians. Constitution says the whole India is for anybody, and Shiv Sena would say Maharashtra is for Maharashtrians, then what is your view? Don't enter into bickerings. You can say, sir, my considered view is this, but I respect the view expressed by you. Don't enter into an argument with the panel. I think last of the no's, don'ts, are never ever bluff. Don't lie. Bluff is a beautiful word. In the heart of your heart, you know that you don't know the answer, but you give the answer. Don't bluff. Who is the winner of this year's Gyanpith Award? And you don't know, but you have some vague recollections. So you say Indira Jaisingh, or you say Dinesh Goswami. While I hope that you know that she is Indira Goswami. Don't bluff. Then what? Then, if you don't know the answer, in a very soft, matter-of-fact tone, say, I am sorry, sir, I don't know. There's nothing wrong in saying, I am sorry, sir, I don't know. The panel doesn't expect you to know everything in the world. If you don't know, say, I am sorry, I don't know. If in a series you come across questions where you have to say this, don't be flustered, because it is possible that the panel may focus in at the start on questions which are not your strong areas. No need to be flustered. If you say no three times, I'm sorry sir, no, I'm sorry sir, don't forget to smile, no, I'm sorry sir, then maybe two of the things may happen. After such sorry three times, four times consecutively, one possibility is panel would say, said, okay, tell us the area in which you are strong. Or after 3-4 questions, there is nothing wrong if you say that I'm sorry, sir, science is not my faculty. I didn't study science. Or if doctors are repeatedly being asked questions on, say, exotic parts of the economy, you are asked what is net present value, what is discounted cash flow. Oh, I doubt even whether even a BCom, MCom or MBA finance, Hyderabad CFA guy may be able to answer this. Or also quickly tell the formula for calculating NPV. You are a doctor, and if the panel goes on asking you about this, or say history, or for a science graduate, or the other way around, for a humanities students, the questions on science, and those also exotic questions, explain genetics, what is decoding, tell us the formula of RNA, basic words, the full word for RNA, ribonucleic acids, or deoxyribon, this is expected of you. But the panel starts asking you details about this one. You can say, sir, I'm sorry, I don't belong to science faculty. And nothing wrong in it. But also remember that your real test also starts after that. Because once either you say that this is my strong area, or the panel says, okay, tell us what is your strong, in which is the area in which you are well prepared. And you say, then remember that your real test begins. Okay. Once you say, I belong to geography faculty, or I'm well prepared at geography, or in history, or there also the panel may ask you, okay, which geography? Global? Or India? Or what? And then you zero in, you say geography of India. Or you say history within which modern India, or freedom struggle, or modern world, or say post Second World War world, or 50 years of independence, whatever is your most favorite. Once you say that, then you must be strong over there. This is also true for a hobby. It's not compulsory to have a hobby. There is nothing wrong if a human being doesn't have a hobby. I don't have a hobby. There are various methods of putting this. You say, I don't need a separate hobby. What is a hobby after all? That you have extra time. And what is your leisure activity? What you do? Someone may like to watch movies, music, philately, collecting friends, reading face, reading hand, whatever. Some useful professional skills at your age. Whatever you want to do. But the hobbies are not come. You can say that I enjoy my life and I don't need a separate hobby. You can say I enjoy studying, etc. But if you say you have a hobby, then you should be knowledgeable in that hobby. You can't say my favorite game is cricket and then you say I don't know anything about cricket. Then you deserve to belong to India's team, not face IS, not face the interview panel. Once you say this, football is my favorite game, then you have a World Cup this year, then you should be knowledgeable in football. Then the panel is likely to ask, tell us what is offside, tell us the rule for offside. Tell us who is Maradona. Tell us the name of the best player. Tell us the winner of the last World Cup. Although that is a consequence of international betting. That also maybe you know, France versus Brazil, in which Ronaldo probably remembered his only then girlfriend, the contemporary girlfriend. So he didn't play well, etc. And the charges are that this was a manipulated. Since I am personally a fan of sports and especially football, I watched the final. This is the worst final I watched ever in my life. I began watching World Cup finals since 1982, and the worst. And one could make out from the way they were playing that this is manipulated. Brazil is incapable of such a bad game unless Brazil also has their own Azharuddins and Ajay Jadejas in the team. You are supposed to know, and once you say football is my favorite game, once you say stamp collection, once you say I like songs, maybe which songs? New ones? Anu Malik's, etc., Nadeem Shravan's, or is it Naushad, Jaydev, Roshan, not the Rajesh Rakesh, his illustrious father, etc. Is it old songs? Which is your favorite singer? If you answer Talat Mehmood and are not able to give any song in it, Jaye to Jaye Kaha, Andhe Jahan Ke Andhe Raste, these are the songs which would be useful to you. I hope, in fact, that they won't be useful after the interview. Talat singing. You say Talat and are not able to tell anything about Talat Mehmood. So the hobby. I suppose I have also made a point on length of your answer, that you shouldn't sound verbose. Now, beyond this, nothing can be expressed in words. People are in the habit of go on talking too much. They go on talking too much. Some people wouldn't explain their position. They would only answer. It is like take it or leave it. You get lost kind of an answer. It is which is very brief, which sounds curt. So how? What length? There are no words for it. Proper length is the only word. Optimum length is the only word. The length which doesn't sound curt and doesn't also sound verbose. Start with one-liners, then as you go on explaining. But one thing I can tell you for sure is you should come down to the point immediately. Not circuitous answers. It should be like Frederick Forsyth's novel, or I would say an excellent English movie, that the story starts with the first frame, not a Hindi movie, which takes its own time to build up the plot. 5 minutes before the interval, the real movie begins. And you know that within 5 minutes after the interval, the movie is over. Rest of it is only academic pursuits, various songs, etc., etc. English, good English movie or a novel, my favorite is Frederick Forsyth, starts with the first sentence. The novel, the story, the pace of the novel. Your answers should start with the first word. Not circuitous, not verbose, not beating around the bush, etc. But sharp, crisp answers. I have been suggesting that you can understand your interview generally in 4 parts. I'm using words very carefully. I'm not saying the interview consists of 4 parts. I'm saying you can understand it in 4 parts. I'm also not saying that these are mandatory 4 parts. I'm saying our understanding. What are these 4? The first one is the introductory part. So approximately what? 2 to 3 minutes? You have sat down, first 1 or 2 questions, one-liners, etc. Okay. Then the interview warms up. I would call the second as takeoff stage. Now you know that the questions have increased, but your length has also increased, the panel and the discussion has begun. There are cross questions, alternative questions, one question leads to the next question, so the debate, the discussion goes on. This may be about another 5 to 6 minutes. Then comes the core content of your interview, the plateau or the apex. Now the aeroplane has taken off and it is reaching the journey, reaching the destination. This is the core content where the debate begins. Then you may explain, it settles. And then towards the end, through their voice, speech, diction, their facial expressions, as you start understanding that now they are approaching summing up. The core content may be about 15, 16, 18 minutes and then it's descent. ATC gives you clearance that your aeroplane may descend. Hope that another aeroplane doesn't crash you. This can happen. In India, this can happen. ATC gives clearance to Kazakh Air to fly, take off on a path, which is exactly defined a path for another Saudi Air aeroplane descending. And they crashed over this village called Charkhi Dadra in Haryana. So it's descent. Then again, your answers shorten. You also start summing up. And then the panel, the chairperson makes it a point to say, okay, excellent. My best wishes, our best wishes for your career. 4 stages. I would repeat that these are not mandatory stage. Sometimes the first 2 may get combined in first minute and it's suddenly a quick takeoff. Sometimes feeling each other may take longer than what you think. But these are generally 4 stages. I will also say that generally your interview would be anywhere between 25 to 35 minutes. Anything less than 25 minutes or anything more than 35 minutes may have extremely good meaning or extremely bad meaning. I hope you have heard me carefully. If it is either less than 25 minutes or more than 35 minutes, both the possibilities are open. And actually you are the person to judge which is the possibility. Less than 25 or more than 35. On the good side, less than 25 may mean you have impressed the panel so much. The panel is also convinced that he made of the stuff of good officers that they're made of. So we need not spend more time with him. Yeah, fine, you are good. So they say, good luck to you. Or more than 35 also means that the panel also gets engrossed in your interview so much and on finding you good, they want to test you more and more, so it goes on beyond 35. This is the positive meaning. There is a possibility of a negative meaning also. Less than 25, and the guy is so useless, why waste our time? So the panel says, okay, thank you very much. Or more than 35, his panel is still trying to give you chance and trying to find out what you are good at. Go on giving the chance, etc. Both the meanings. But when you give the interview, you know, you are the judge and you know. What are your answers? How many times you said, I don't know? How many times you felt confused? How many times you felt like doing this? Or shifting, or you may not be disturbed at the beginning, but you go on getting disturbed as the interview proceeds. So the 4 areas. Now I took my own time to also talk of these four areas, because now I am about to tell you a certain professional skill in what I said at the beginning, how to steer your interview to your strong points. A general guideline is you can steer your interview on strong points. Sometimes you can do it directly, and it is like I have already said. You go on saying, I don't know, I don't know, I don't know. And then you say, I'm sorry, sir, this is not my area, I'm strong on this. Or the panel asks. But there are some subtle methods of doing this. We have a successful candidate, Chanakya Mandal student, successful student last year. And she must have completed her first phase just now, Prajakta. And the two candidates who also joined NDA, they had worked in Kutch. So something on the earthquake came up. And very softly this candidate said, things about earthquake, referring to, this is what I experienced when I participated relief activities in Kutch. And this is a signal to the panel. The panel is immediately going to say, did you participate? You went to Kutch? And then it comes on your strong areas. There are various methods. If you get down to personal discussion as and when we open up, then I can suggest you, this needs, you should know yourself, therefore you should know your strong points. And if the questions come that way, the natural questions come that way. It's again cricket. You should know the ball. Someone is strong on the on, someone is strong on the off. You are good at a particular shot, or you also have to see the field and then place your ball between the two fielders. How do you do that? You steer that ball. Every ball has a range. It's not one directional. Every ball can be played in a certain range. And your skill as a good batsman is how to judge the field and place it from below the, from between the fielders to scorer's boundary, or how to lift the ball. So it is playing each delivery on its own merit, but on your strong points. So you know that if you are strong on the on, how to convert those deliveries. So the good batsman in the mandatory overs would change his stance, would get into the leg offside line, or would get outside the line, depending on whether he's strong on the on or off. It's similar, your movement, intellectual movement. But you can steer your interview on the strong points of your personality. I should also say that it's not binding on you to give pro-government answers on various issues. It's not binding at all. I would say what is binding is your answer should be balanced, well substantiated. Sometimes we think that we are about to join government service. Here is a panel which is already working with the government. So your answer must be pro-government. And pro which government? The present government sitting. Whichever is the present government sitting. So you are asked a question, what is your opinion on the latest budget presented by the finance minister? You are not bound, it's not mandatory on you to say it's an excellent budget. Within limitations, Yashwant Sinha has done his best. War is about to take place, and so surcharges were required. We have fiscal deficit, we have revenue deficit, we have accumulated losses, we have oil pool deficit, and the World Bank is sitting on our head to cut down government expenditure, blah blah blah. So this budget, sometimes tough decisions have to be taken, etc. You know. You can say, you are bound to say. The point is, your answer should be well substantiated. It shouldn't sound fanatic, it shouldn't sound one-sided, it shouldn't be like, this guy is not thinking in a balanced way, he's just making his point. So not necessarily pro-government, but it should be balanced. Now once in a while, if the panel cuts you halfway through, stop there. You are giving an answer, but someone from the panel asked the next question. Don't drag your answer. Don't tell the panelist, may I complete the earlier answer? Or please let me complete the earlier. No. Immediately go to the next question. Stop your answer over there. Smile. Stop your answer there and go to the next question. The only proviso is, if the next question is related to the earlier question and therefore your next answer also would be related to this one, then you can complete and say, I'm coming to that. So you complete the earlier answer, but never say, never retort, never ask, may I complete my earlier answer? I want to complete my earlier answer. Sir, give me chance to complete my earlier answer. We feel flustered that my answer is incomplete. Would the panel give me less marks? No. Remember that in fact the panel wants to find out how you handle this situation, that you are cut halfway through. Do you get angry? Do you get flustered? Or does the inertia of your answer draw you into completing the same answer without paying attention to what is the next question that has been asked? So go to the next question immediately. And like I said, if it is related, then only come to this. I have also said, don't bluff. It doesn't mean don't guess. You may guess, but you have to say so. If you are guessing, then you can say, sir, I am not sure. Let me guess. I think this may be the answer. You can guess. But if you are guessing, make it a point to mention that you are guessing. Then once in a while, you may come across a question, the answer of which needs some drawing or something. Staircase circuit. Or you are asked to show the line of control, Kashmir. Instead of saying in words, there may be blank papers and a pencil there. Or invariably where the panel sits by, behind them would be a blackboard, a green board, whatever. You can say this is Kashmir, this is the line of control. So these are Hunzas, Kardu, Gilgit, etc. Your answer sounds better. Or especially the questions in science or medical, etc. Then instead of giving an answer in words, you can say, tell us about the nervous system or about the brain. Then you can draw the brain, various glands very quickly and point out this is here, this is here, etc. Instead of describing. So it can be a flow chart, it can be a table, it can be mitosis, mitosis. You can show it, cell division. Instead of describing cell division, you can show it stage 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. So sometimes you can use drawings, figures, circuit, map, etc. Sometimes the candidates, youngsters are also under the impression that it's again mandatory on them to make their answer sound witty or funny. Please remember that it's not mandatory. If witty or funny answers come up spontaneously, then they are welcome. If they come up spontaneously, then don't stop. But don't make it a point that I should crack a joke once every 5 minutes. That there has to be a kissa or a quip or a line from a poem or some refer to some Lakshman's cartoon or something. Neither this way nor that way. Don't wear a square face. Be light-hearted, easy. But not mandatory that you must crack a joke. You are likely to end up by cracking a poor joke. In fact, with the one that shows you in a bad light, in a poor light. But a witty answer. We had a, once in a while, we had a candidate named Rajni. Priya Tendulkar serial called Rajni, which is who was a firebrand lady fighting against injustice wherever she would find it. So this lady Rajni was asked, what is the difference between you Rajni and Rajni on TV screen? She said, I am true Rajni, she is a fictitious Rajni. Beautiful answer, a correct quip. And in one line she has said so much, but it has to come spontaneously. Don't plan a joke, don't plan a witty answer. A joke, witty answer, or if once in a while the panel also cracks a joke, don't feel shy to smile or laugh. You may not ha 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 guffa sitting on the chair, not this, but the panel cracks a joke and you maintain a square face. In fact, the insult for a joke is not to laugh with the joke. The panel is going to say, I cracked a joke and this guy is not laughing. Does he have sense of humor? So this one. Last but one of the content part is beware of change of pace. The title I have given to this is beware of change of pace. What is change of pace? The panel, one of the panelists starts with one question. Maybe something absolutely contemporary. Palestine problem. What is happening between Yasser Arafat and Sharon? Why does he say this is a war on terrorism? What is Yasser Arafat's reaction? Where is his house, Ramallah? I've been watching it across last so many days. I thought this is the only better one would have been Manmohan Desai with Amar Akbar Anthony. Because Ramallah has Rama and Allah both. So the PLO has headquarters at Ramallah, the name, etc. And then suddenly someone says, what is Shivaji's birthday? Define the concept of Hindavi Swaraj. This is change of pace. You enter into one world, from one world to the next. I would say even these are correlated. But if the sequence on questions on Palestine and suddenly the next question is, tell us the speed of light. How many minutes light requires for traveling from sun to the earth, etc. Or what is the last planet found out in the solar system? 10th one, called Poseidon. Doesn't limit at 9th. 9th was Pluto. But last couple of years, some it's more than 5-6 years, but the 10th one. Or the question on science, suddenly the next question is taxation policy. The area changes. I have called this intellectual pasteurization. Sudden change from one to the next area. You must have quick wit to change your this thing. You are shaping up for a stroke, and then you suddenly know that I was about to play this ball as a leg spin while it is googly. And to bring down your bat suddenly, these are beautiful metaphors from cricket. You were shaping up for a stroke on the front foot, and you suddenly have to get on the back foot and push the ball, dab the ball. Or that you were shaping up for a defensive stroke, but you know it's an overpitch ball, and you can lift it above the fielder's head, whatever. Change of pace, sudden changes, don't dwell upon the earlier part. Quick-wittedness, fast mind. That it goes quickly, it goes to the next issue on hand and addresses to the next question. Beware of the change of pace. The last and the most important part is the areas on which possible questions may come up. Some of the areas. Nobody can ever define all the areas. Nobody can ever guess all the questions, because you must have seen the gazette notification and it says anything under the sun. What kind of questions may be asked? It is anything under the sun. But we try and place this anything under the sun in certain categories. So you may have questions obviously on current events. You should be well read. Especially please make it a point to read the newspaper on the day on which you are going there. One of the almost compulsory questions is, which newspapers do you read and have you read today's newspaper? My suggestion is, don't read only one newspaper, read more than one newspaper, minimum two, hopefully more than that. Because each newspaper or a magazine or a TV channel has its own editorial policy, and in order to develop a balanced and well-substantiated opinion, you should know what are the various opinions. CNN has a one outlook, BBC has another, Aaj Tak would have another one, Zee News has another one, etc. Star News would have still another one, so you listen to the debate, form your opinion. So also newspapers, Hindu, Indian Express, Times of India, and what not. Make it a point to read more than one newspaper, send newspaper of the day. Then next area is obviously some questions on your optionals. Brush them up. You need not be as deeply prepared as you were for the main examination. Brush up your optionals. Then rest of the parts of general studies, so maybe constitution, maybe some questions on science and technology, some etc. GS, subcomponents of general studies. Then about name and things related to your name and your basic biodata, birth date, place of birth, place of residence, the state in which you reside, original place to which you belong, what is its history, sociology, culture, references, the latest references, why, if the place was in the news, why was it in the news, all related. I have put them as your autobiographical questions. About degree, which degree, then what are your optionals. If your optionals are different from your degree subject, invariably expect a question on this, you took a degree in this and your optionals are different from the why so, would you explain, etc. Then an almost invariable question is, why do you want to join civil service? And yet another equally important part of it is, what are your choices? Why so? And once you fix your choices, IAS, IPS, IFS, whichever is the first one, second, third, then the reasons, and you should also then know about the service. If you say that my choice is IPS, then you should know how you start once you become an IPS officer. What are your promotional avenues? What are the scales for payment? What is the posting policy? What is career prospect? What would be your career graph? You give option, say second, third, fourth, or even first one. Once in a while, there are candidates who have given the first option to customs service, excise service, revenue service, for whatever are their reasons. But the general trend being, top three are considered as IAS, IFS, IPS. So if some candidate says, I want to join customs service, then, or even the second choice is customs, why customs? Then how would you start if you are selected and you become a customs officer, how would you start? What are your career prospects? So knowing about the service. Then it is the area of questions I am calling as situational questions. Situational is, you are posted in Akola, how would you handle the situation? It's a communal right, how would you handle the situation? Or if you were DM Kutch when earthquake occurred on 26 January last year, tell us what would you do? What are the immediate steps you would take? Flood, foreign policy, you are posted to Kabul as representative of India, what would you do? Various these kind of, a common citizen is approaching you, a farmer telling you that he is not getting 712 extract of his own farm. Situational questions, you are asked to handle a situation. So how would you handle this situation? Then hobbies. What are your hobbies? And I have already covered this point. This is almost the last point. Doctors and engineers must be absolutely invariably prepared to face a question. Why, in spite of being a doctor or an engineer, you want to join civil service? And various ways in which this question is paraphrased is the same question put in different. You are a professional, you are a doctor, society through government has invested you in making you a doctor or an engineer. So you should use that specialist knowledge in that sector. So instead of you becoming a doctor or an engineer, you join a civil service, your knowledge is wasted. So the money invested in you so far, the fees you paid, and some 10 times or 20 times the fees you paid is the expenditure the society has incurred on you. And the panel may ask, why should they come? There are various answers. Whenever we discuss those answers, it's possible. So also maybe various backgrounds. You should know about these theories called the generalist approach to administration and the specialist approach to administration. The latest upcoming debate also about generalist administration. This is bureaucrats and technocrats, etc. Your sound answer. This is all that I wanted to say about the interview in the beginning. After all, like I have been saying through the course of my talk, it's at the end of the day, it is you playing each delivery on its own merit and go on to score the, not only the century for yourself, but the victory for you and the team. So my best wishes to all of you. We'll take a break here. Let us see if we devote some, just about 5 minutes. Are there any question you would like to ask immediately? Raise immediately right now. Okay, so my watch does so 5 minutes to 12.
Can I ask one question on the idea?
Yeah, fine.
Supposing two panel members ask a question at a time. Means the situation might arise.
Yeah.
How do you handle that
situation? I would say various ways. The basic answer is, you say, this is a very good question and actually you should think of these questions. But maybe you are now itching to give your interview. Basic answer in principle is, take any one question first, but say so, that may I answer this first and then I'll come to your question, sir. But then there are certain criteria within this policy. If one of the two members is a chairperson, and the other is someone else, then answer the chairperson's question first. And says, okay, sir, may I take this question first and I'll come to your question next, sir. Okay. Again, if one of the two members is a lady, then the answer the lady's question first. Another Hippocratic snobbery in our society of showing respect to women only in the places where it may not be required. Respect and equality and the relationship of equality and mutual respect everywhere outside the panel or something is a larger matter of life. But at least also in the panel, not at least, I'm saying also in the panel, then address the lady's question first. And then if it is a chairperson and a lady, then the chairperson first, because chairpersons don't have gender. Chairperson, so I'm carefully using the word chair. I don't know how many of you know the evolution of this word chairperson. The normally existing word until 1983 was chairman. India hosted 7th summit of non-aligned movement in Delhi. I think in 83 the 7th summit was scheduled for Colombo or something. But then Colombo and Sri Lanka was engrossed in this ethnic conflict. So the place had to be changed. So Indiraji, as the then Prime Minister, offered to host this one, and she coordinated all the activities. For all practical purpose, this is an analysis of political science, we are free to differ, but by and large, this 1983 summit conference of non-aligned movement countries is considered as the climax of non-aligned movement. Because after that, beginning with 84, you have Gorbachev, collapse of Soviet Russia, collapse of communist empire, China changing policies, and by 1990, capitalism and America emerging as the only winners. So there are no two camps in which the world is divided, so there is no question of non-alignment, etc. This goes on happening beyond 84. 83 was the last time. In 1983, the method was that the earlier chairman has to hand over to the new one. Sixth summit was held at Havana, capital city of Cuba. And their president was and still is Fidel Castro. So they were sitting on the dais, the plenary session was going on, and Fidel Castro handed over the charge and says that henceforth the new chairman would be Indira Gandhi. She took objection to this word, Indira Gandhi being Indira Gandhi. She said, what is this chairman? There is no chairman. Then he said, should I say what? One says chairwoman, chair lady. What does one say? This is how then Indiraji suggested it is a chairperson. Gender awareness, which reflects equality in society, is a modern development. So the chairperson. How did I start? If the chairperson and a lady, two different ones, then address the chairperson's answer first and then go to the lady. But the point also to be remembered is, you listen to two questions raised by two people, don't make the mistake of answering only one and sitting quietly. I don't know if you have felt this. You were talking to someone, you asked a question, and the person just didn't answer. I am talking to you, I am talking here, you ask a question and I address him. You feel offended. Invariably, you say, I raised a question and this guy is not aware, is not answering. But in addition to feeling offended, maybe even as a matter of test, two panel members may speak simultaneously, only to see how you react to that. So also remember to take first question and then also go to the next. Finish that. At the back of your mind, you have to remember the second question. God forbid if you happen to forget the second question. Then nothing is wrong in saying you complete the answer and then say, sir, now I'm prepared to take your question, but would you please repeat the question? Any other question? Sure. We will start interviews, mock interviews at 12:15. Now, is Swati going to...